Hello and welcome to today's Saratech Enablement session. My name is Monique Anderson. I'm the Marketing Coordinator at Saratech and I will be your host today. Presenting today, we have Derek Barkey, who is the Director of Advanced Engineering here at Saratech, and he'll be talking about using super elements in FEMAP. Next slide, please. The goal of our enablement sessions is to help you get the most out of your Siemens PLM software, share knowledge, and build a community of users. Twice a month, we meet online to learn about tips, tricks, new and old features that will help you in your everyday tasks. Please go ahead and visit our Saratech YouTube channel to check out all our past sessions. And please remember, this is an open forum, so if you have questions or comments during the presentation, please type them in the chat box to the right of your screen, and I'll kindly interrupt Derek to let him know your comments and questions. And with that, I'll pass the baton to Derek. Thank you.
Thanks, Monique. So before I start, just a little background about Saratech, if you're not familiar with us. We were established more than 15 years ago, and we have a team of 50 engineers in our technical group who do consulting as well as software support for our customers. We're headquartered in Mission Viejo, California, which is where I'm speaking to you from right now. But we have engineers and salespeople distributed around the country to help support our customers. And we are, in fact, Siemens' number one channel partner in North America. Today, I'm going to talk about super elements. We're going to cover how super elements work, including a little bit of math. We're going to talk about creating super elements with FEMAP, and we're going to talk about using super elements with FEMAP. Unfortunately, a relatively brief webinar like this can't do full justice to super elements. There's an entire manual devoted to them, and there's also entire training courses devoted to them. So if you have an interest in a deeper understanding of super elements, feel free to contact your Saratech account manager. So let's talk a little bit about non-super elements, just your regular everyday garden variety element. When you define an element for Nastran, it takes all the information you provide about that element to generate an element stiffness, mass, damping, and load matrix. These matrices are associated with the degrees of freedom of the element. So in the case of a four-noded quad, it goes to the four corners, the nodes on the four corners. All these individual element matrices are assembled into one big model matrix. Superelements are analogous. They too have a matrix associated with their degrees of freedom. But their matrices are made by taking the matrices of component elements, elements that are inside the superelement, and reducing those to just the external degrees of freedom, the degrees of freedom around, typically around the edges of the element. And we call this process of generating this superelement element matrix reduction. Anything that's not in a superelement, we would call the residual, which is sometimes called superelement number zero. So you're probably already using super elements, you just don't know it. Every time you run a model, it's basically a residual, unless you've attached or created super elements from it. So how does this reduction process work? So super elements partition the degrees of freedom into this internal set, i.e. all of the nodes that are inside the super element, and an external set, i.e. an A set, which are all of the degrees of freedom on the exterior of the element that the other model can interact with. So anything that's in the A set, you can connect to the rest of your model. Anything that's part of the O set is internal to the super element and can't interact with the rest of the model. The degrees of freedom for the O set are really a combination of deflections due to loads inside the superelement. So if you have pressures, for example, inside your superelement, those pressures cause those internal degrees of freedom to deform. But what happens on the exterior of the superelement, what happens in the rest of the model, will also affect those degrees of freedom inside the superelement. So we have basically two subsets of the O set. Those displacements that come about due to the loads internal to the superelement, which we call fixed, and those that come about due to the deflections of the exterior nodes, which we call free. The implication of this is the super element is effectively a black box. The solution only actually sees the A set, and the O set are kind of hidden from the rest of the model. But we can calculate those based on the A set deflections. So a little math, how does it actually go about doing this? It starts off by taking your super element stiffness matrix. It takes all the elements, assembles them together into a super element stiffness matrix. And then it rearranges the order of everything. It partitions them into the O set and the A set, which is what you see in that first row of matrix equations. If you look at the super element manual, they then change nomenclature on us. They then decide to stop calling it the A set and call it the T set to be a little more generic regarding the super element degrees of freedom. So don't get confused by that. The A set and the T set are effectively equivalent. The little bars refer to the fact that we're talking about loads on those degrees of freedom due to loads inside the super element rather than loads from outside. So that's what the bar refers to. If we do a little math, we multiply the first row of that matrix equation by the column of displacements, we get the equation that you see on the bottom left. We rearrange this and solve for it in terms of the O-set displacements, and you get the equation you see in the upper right. So the left term of that equation is the displacements of the internal degrees of freedom, the O-set, due to the external displacements. So you can see that's written in terms of the UT, or the external degrees of freedom. The right term is the internal displacements due to the internal loads, or the PO, that you see there. So this tells us basically what the internal displacements of those degrees of freedom will be. Now, keep in mind that equation, which I've repeated here in the upper left, and you'll see what the standard procedure for Nastran is to pull out that KOO inverse times KOT and call it GOT. And GOT is very important for superelements. It's basically what allows us to relate external degrees of freedom to internal degrees of freedom. So it gets used a lot as part of the superelement process. Now let's go back to that original equation and multiply the second row. And when we do that with a little bit of manipulation, this will give us the reduced loads on the exterior degrees of freedom. So these are the loads from the interior appearing to the rest of the model on the exterior. So between these two things, we can get a reduced stiffness for the exterior degrees of freedom, a reduced load for the exterior degrees of freedom, and we can also get the conversion between the interior and external degrees of freedom. So that's all the math I'm going to talk about, I promise. But hopefully that gives you a little bit of idea that this is not magic, there's really sound math behind it. So why do we care? Why would we even want to use superelements? Well, superelements are analogous to parts and assemblies in a CAD system. If you're used to working with CAD models, you know that typically you start off with simple basic building blocks, and then you group those into assemblies, and then you group those into even higher assemblies. And you can reuse some of these basic parts in multiple assemblies. Well, superelements are basically the same sort of thing. They allow you to organize your model into logical pieces and then combine them together at the end to do one analysis. The other thing superelements do for you is they can reduce the size of a nonlinear model. So if you're doing a large nonlinear analysis and only a portion of your model is actually behaving nonlinearly, you can take the linear pieces, put them into a superelement, and they then just basically become boundary stiffnesses for your nonlinear. So your model will run much more quickly. Also, this is much more efficient for large models, since all you're really doing is calculating what happens to the residual. So if you have a large model, you don't have to keep calculating the same matrices over and over again. You put those matrices into a superelement or a variety of superelements and just reuse them. The final reason people tend to use superelements is the fact that you have this black box nature. You don't necessarily know what's going on inside the superelement. You just interact with those external degrees of freedom. And so what this allows companies to do is provide necessary stiffness and load data to a partner or to a subcontractor without revealing all of the details of what is structurally going on inside that. So it allows you to kind of compartmentalize your finite element model and make it more private. So there's two different types of superelements that we're going to talk about. One we call internal superelements, and an internal superelement gets created on the fly every time you run your model. So you're not really saving the data, you're just regenerating it every time. There are actually two different ways to do internal superelements. There's what we call a main bulk superelement, which is an old style approach that's based on assigning nodes and elements to a specific superelement. There's a newer way to do it called a part superelement, where every superelement basically is its own Nastran input file with its own begin bulk card associated with it. Nastran will actually put these parts together and assemble them. So each one of these parts could even be in a separate file, and you just merge them all together with include statements. So if you have a model that came from a supplier and you want to embed it in your model, your larger system model, you can just treat it like a part superelement, not worry about having to renumber nodes and elements and so forth. You just drop it in, and Nastran will put it together based on looking for coincident nodes. It's basically going to merge it for you, just like you would be able to merge it, say, in FEMAP, merge duplicate coincident nodes together. Nastran will do that for you based on superelements. So that's the newer way to do things, and I'll show you an example in a second. It's also possible, as I said earlier, to create superelements where you store the matrices and reuse them over and over again, and that's done through external superelements. So these are created once in a separate Nastran analysis, and then they can be transferred or reused. And you can store these matrices in either output two files, output four files, or a punch file. So let's talk about how this works in FEMAP. For this external superelement, where we're generating it and then saving it, we define the ASET, the external degrees of freedom that we want to associate with this superelement, as a degree of freedom set inside FEMAP, and then we go run the model. Anything that's not part of this external degree of freedom set is assumed to be the OSET. And Nastran will then go do an analysis for you, created that reduced stiffness and that reduced loads matrix that I described earlier, store those in either an output two or an output four or a punch file, and then let you reuse them. So it's a very simple process in FEMAP. All you basically have to do is define for FEMAP what the external degrees of freedom are, and Nastran takes it from there. If you want to do internal superelements, remember there are two different methods here, the main bulk or the newer part superelements. The main bulk is supported by FEMAP. You can assign nodes to specific superelements. Support for the part superelements is not quite as refined in FEMAP, but it's quite possible with a little bit of planning and data management. So we'll talk about that. So creating an external superelement. So what I have here is kind of a representative model, and I want the nodes on the end to become part of the ASET. Okay. ASET definition in FEMAP is treated as a special case of a constraint. So if you're used to creating constraint sets in FEMAP, you'll find this is essentially the same thing. Same user interface, same process. So what you see here is creating your constraint set. I'm going to call it ASET, just so I know what it is. And then when I go to run my analysis, underneath where you specify the constraints, the loads, and so forth, you'll see there is an option to specify ASET for your ASET. So you simply select the constraint set that you created earlier, and Nastran will then use that for your ASET. And it gets written out into the Nastran input file like you see on the left. Very simple input, simply ASET, the grid ID, and which degrees of freedom for that grid that you want to have included in the ASET. And that's really all there is to it. If you want to tell Nastran though specifically how you want it to store the matrices, there's also an option inside the analysis of FEMAP to do that. And so this lets you specify which matrices do you want. So for example, if all you want is the stiffness matrix, then you can see there you simply check stiffness, don't check mass, don't check damping, don't check loads, and it won't create it. We'll only create the stiffness for you. You'll notice that It allows you to specify how to output it. In this case, we're outputting it to the punch file. It also gives you an option to assign an ID number to the super element, in this case 10. And what gets written out then when you actually run NASTRAN, since we asked for it to be in a punch file, is what you see on the left. That's actually what you would see inside your punch file. And NASTRAN stores this as what's called a DMIG card, or DMIG. And so you'll sometimes hear people refer to external super elements as DMIGs. So all the DMIG is, in this case, is just the stiffness matrix for the A set that's been reduced. So if you hear someone refer to a DMIG matrix, that's probably what they're referring to. It stands for direct matrix input on grid. So that would be creating external super elements with FEMAT. How do you go about using them? It's actually easier than it used to be. So that punch file that you created with the stiffness matrices references specific grid numbers, hence the term direct matrix input on grid. That punch file will also contain the grid cards for those grids. So now you've told NASTRAN not only what the stiffness matrix is at the external nodes, but you've told it where those external nodes are. If you use an output 2 or an output 4, it doesn't have a provision for saving that grid data, since those are set up strictly for tables and matrices. So NASTRAN will create a separate ASM file with the grid data. If you include those grid cards along with the matrices, NASTRAN will look for grid points located in the same locations in the rest of the model and will merge things together for you. So it's almost a completely automatic process to use these external superelements. All you really have to do is just include the data. Okay? And FEMAP supports that as well. You know, so there's an external superelement reference when you go to create an analysis set, and you simply have to tell it where those files are, what the superelement ID associated with each file is, and so forth, and it will write out the appropriate NASTRAN file that will use your external superelements for you. So it's pretty much an automated process in FEMAP as well. So that's how external superelements work. How do internal superelements? So again, an internal superelement is a superelement that gets created every time you run your model. So it's not a separate file, it's not reusable, but it has the benefits I talked about earlier of making your model smaller, more manageable, making your nonlinear model more efficient, and so forth. And the easiest way to go about doing this is to simply assign the grids of the degrees of freedom that are internal to a superelement. So this is a little bit different than external. In an external superelement, you actually define which grids are on the exterior of the superelement, the A set grids. With internal superelements, you're actually defining the O set grids. And this shows up in the NASTRAN input file on the grid card in the far right. You'll see that there's a field for superelement ID, in this case, 20. It's possible to do this as a meshing attribute, so you can assign it to a solid or a surface or a curve before you mesh it. Any elements or any nodes, rather, that are created from those will be associated with that superelement. Or you can do it after you mesh, after the fact, by going into the Modify menu. Look for Update Other at the bottom, and you'll see you have an option there to specify superelement ID for nodes after the fact. So any node then assigned to that superelement becomes interior to it. FEMAP also provides some group functions to allow you to visualize and manipulate your superelements. So if you look under the group menu, you'll find some options for generating groups based on their superelement. So if you've assigned things to superelements but kind of lost track of which nodes are in which superelement, you can easily generate groups based on those. Or if you've imported a model that has superelements and you want to visualize them, again, you can create groups based on them, be able to look at specific superelements, turn them on and off using the group functionality. I'm going to talk a little bit more about part superelements. So these are super elements that are actually embedded inside your model. I mentioned this earlier because it actually is a newer feature and perhaps not as well understood. Each super element is essentially its own self-contained Nastran input file. So this is typically something, say, that you've received from another engineer in your company. So he's created a local finite element model and you want to incorporate that into your assembly model. Or maybe you received it from a supplier and you want to incorporate it into your assembly model. Well, as long as you have nodes in your model that line up with nodes in this super element model, Nastran will combine them together without regard to duplicate IDs or anything else. They all get put into one big input file with the main residual model, your model that you're attaching these to at the very beginning, and then each one then is delineated by a begin super equals card where the super equals identifies the identification number for the super element. Nastran will then look for coincident nodes, merge those together. FEMAP won't create these part super elements, but you can still use them with FEMAP. You can still generate them with FEMAP. You can still create a model around them, but it requires a little bit of finesse. First thing you'd want to do if you're trying to create a part super element or break your existing model up into multiple part super elements is you would put each of them in their own group. And then once you have them in a separate group, then you can export them individually. So when you go to use the analysis generation function of FEMAP, rather than writing out the entire model, you can specify just write out a specific group. In this case, super element 30 would be written out. So that then becomes its own input file. And you have to go in with a text editor and clean out probably any executive control and case control that might have been included, since we don't really need that for our super element. All we really need is just the bulk data. So once you've done that editing, then you can include this into your master model as a part super element. Typically, you'll do that with include statements in the bulk data for your model. So rather than actually putting all these cards back into your model, you'll typically leave them as their separate file that will then be embedded at runtime. So graphically, it would look something like this. In this case, we've got three super elements and a residual. So super element one, super element two, and super element three reside in their own separate files, se1.bdf, se2.bdf, and se3.bdf. So then when we go to use this, we have a bulk data file of the residual. It's basically all the rest of your model that's not in super element. And then we just add at the end of it, begin super equals one and include that appropriate file, begin super equals two, include the super element two file, and so forth. And so then Nastran will take it from there and combine all of your super elements together with your residual and give you a complete analysis of the entire assembly. If you've got a model like this with these include files of super elements, you can import them into FEMAP. FEMAP, however, won't like having duplicate node IDs or element IDs. Even though Nastran tolerates that when they're in super elements, FEMAP will want to renumber them when you import them. But that's typically okay. You can still let it renumber them. You can still write them back out as super elements and use them. To help with that, it's a good idea when you do your imports to go into preferences and either select create groups from include files or preserve include files. Creating groups from include files basically will take each of your super elements and create a group for you. Preserve include statements means that when you write it back out, if you have an include statement, it will preserve that include statement and write it back out for you so you don't have to manually edit it. So those are two helpful preference options when dealing with external part super elements. So in summary, super elements are a useful technique for managing complex models. They make your models more modular. They make your models more private. They can reduce the size of your analysis set. FEMAP can create and manage your super element models for you. And if you want more details, Refer to the FEMAP User Manual or to the NASGEN SuperElement User's Guide for more details. Thank you for your attention. I'm Derek Barkey with Ceratec Incorporated.
Thank you so much, Derek, for a very informational presentation today on SuperElements. And to our attendees, please don't forget to check out our next session on What's New in Solid Edge ST11, Part 1. This will be a two-part series, and the first one starts August 2nd. Presenter is Kelsey Safar. Next slide, please. And then if you're ready to take it to the next level, we offer our engineering services to address your demand for advanced engineering capabilities. And we also provide additive manufacturing services and 3D printers by Markforge, HP, and BigRep. Thank you everyone for attending today. We will be posting this video to YouTube later today. Feel free to pass along to your friends and colleagues, and be sure to subscribe to our channel, follow us on Twitter and LinkedIn for upcoming CES session dates and topics. And if you could please stick around for about 10 seconds after to fill out our survey, let us know how we did and what you liked. We really appreciate your feedback. Thank you everyone so much, and have a great rest of your day.